Hi and welcome to You Little Ripper. I'm Kurt Fearnley, former Paralympian, and on today's show, finally, accusations of tightness get levelled at moi.
Are they true?
No!
No?
Yes.
You've done a lot of things in your life and career, Kurt Fearnley. Have you ever willingly bought someone a coffee?
A free coffee should count.
All right, we're going to investigate this further. I'm Georgie Tunny, ABC sport reporter and unofficial number one ticket holder for the Paralympic Games. We are broadcasting from Wurundjeri country, as we do every day on You Little Ripper. Kurt Fearnley, you've had about 2 hours sleep. What had you screaming, You Little Ripper, last night?
Our two Australian table tennis
Yes.
That was Lina Lei and also Yang Chen. They were two amazing matches. I haven't seen that much table tennis in my entire life, but I loved it. It was so great. And there was so much of that to love. I was yelling, You Little Ripper, every single point, when they got the gold medal, when they got on the podium, and then when they did the interview together.
Oh.
It's just a beautiful part of the green and gold that it needs to represent, you know, 60,000 years of history, but also welcome the newest of arrivals. And when Yan Chen was speaking in Mandarin and it being interpreted by Lina Lei, I just thought that was amazing, welcoming. And that's what the green and gold is. It's this huge spectrum of people that call Australia home and want to represent it abroad. It was a fantastic moment.
So Lina Lei and also Yang Chen and also Ma Lin, they came across to Australia after Rio. So they moved from China and now representing Australia to great success. But I think you're right, Kurt. It was the level of joy that they both had talking to each other after their performances. They are so genuinely excited to represent Australia and their new lifestyles here. I loved Lina Lei last night when she was asked, you know, what's your favourite thing about being Australian now? And she's like, it's my preferred lifestyle. Just still serious, but just so happy about it. And what performances we've seen from this team. Two golds, two silvers now, and we're going to head into the teams event.
Yeah, the best event that we have ever done in table tennis was 1964, where we won one gold and three silver medals. Already we have two gold and two silvers, so that is just on its own, amazing. The last time we won a gold medal in table tennis was 1984.
Gosh.
So it was also Sam von Eyman got the silver and Marlene silver earlier on in the week. But there was also another moment in the interview when Lina Lei was asked about her team, and she goes, this is not just a team, they are my family.
Yes.
And that beautiful moment as well, that culture of the Australian Paralympic team, about being supportive, about being a family, to see that in again, one of our newest competitors who has experienced so much success when she represented China. That was perfect for me.
My You Little Ripper moment last night happened on the track. It was in the field events. It was the javelin. Michael Burian won silver and broke a world record. How is this possible, you ask? He was competing in the F64. His class is F44. So, Kurt, I want you to explain to me how the classes work and why, if you break a world record, you may not necessarily win gold.
It is because there's multi-disability in the one event sometimes, they do a percentage of the world record. So, okay, if you go over your specific world record that is in your classification, because to make an even playing field across disability groups, they have to classify you into different functional abilities, I guess. And then you line up against people from other classifications, percentage of the world record will be the winner. It just so happened that there were multiple world record holders yesterday. So that meant you could break your own world record and still be short. But that's the level of competition here.
That was it. And that was it, was the competitiveness between the athletes. But for Burian to throw 66.29 metres. He had the Paralympic spirit as he was just launching that spear, technical term, that spear into the field. And for it to record that, just the yell that came from him when he saw it go over the 65 line, and he just knew that it was huge. And it was just this yell of relief, but also joy.
I was really confused when you started saying that that's your Ulu Ripper moment, because you're half dolphin.
Yes.
I was going to assume that you would have gone to the 4x100 meter, 34 points, men's freestyle.
Yes.
But
yep.
Now I know why. Your obsession with storming the gates of Mordor, and you've thought, I'm going to start recruiting again. So you've went straight to the javelin. Congratulations.
I'm going to need the best team when I storm Mordor. So why can't I have the silver medalist in Burien? I think that's allowed.
I think that you're in the right place. Look, if I'm going to storm the gates, I'm going to get the strongest people in the world.
Yes.
Well, that is the Australian Paralympic team. Why not get the one that knows how to utilise a weapon to quite a long distance?
Yeah, to great effect.
To great effect.
Kurt, I do have to let you in on a little secret. So, Michael Burien, congratulations. Here's my You Little Ripper moment. But I was pretty nervous, pretty anxious during that relay race last night, the 4x100 metres freestyle, 34 points, gold medal, world record. This can neither confirm nor deny if this was me.
Yes! Yes, 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 yes. I've just been cheering. Oh, the last time. Well done, Popham. You little ripper! Oh, God.
So I could actually hear you from the other side of the city last night. So that's why I thought straight away that this is going to be your You Little Ripper moment.
Oh.
But it's got to be the best of the rest. What an amazing performance. And Rowan Crothers, friend of the show.
Friend of the show.
And Ben Popham, friend of the show. With Will Martin and Matt Levy. That was so good.
I don't think I've regained my breath. I don't. And you could hear it there. I was pretty out of breath. I haven't regained it because for me it was the lead off lap from Rowan Crothers. He swam faster in that relay than he did in his individual event, 51.35. And then to finish at home, Ben Popham. We know how great mates they are out of the pool. But he held off the Italian team. The Italian sprinter was coming at him so fast, but he held his lead and he touched first, touched in world record time. It's the best of the rest. It's amazing. Also, Kurt, best of the rest. And it's happened this morning. A gold, a silver, a bronze in the road cycling. And they're names that we know, we've talked about before. Darren Hicks, Emily Petrocola, Meg Lemon.
That was such it's the perfect way to start the road cycling. We have such a strong team in the cycling event. We've spoken about how they literally will only take you, only the medalists, like those who are potential to get gold, silver and bronze. That's how tight the selection process is.
So it's really hard to get on this team.
It is just phenomenally hard. You might see a few development athletes make it into the larger teams, your athletics and swimming, but in the cycling, they are knife edge. It was so great to see Meg Lemon get on the podium for that bronze medal. She was fourth place earlier in the week, and to see Darren Hicks get that as well. When we saw him win his silver medal in the velodrome, and he immediately spoke about the road race is where I'm at. This time trial on the road is where I'm at. That's where my preparation has been building. To see that all work out for him, that is so amazing.
Especially because when we spoke to him, we got his reaction about the first time he even put on his Paralympic kit, and he was crying because it meant that much to him. He raced today in the time trial. He finished in 34 minutes, 39 seconds, 0.78, 1.5 minutes ahead of the silver medalist.
Amazing. It was just a sensational ride, and I'm so happy for him, his family, his connections, his coaches. It was just sensational, and also for Emily Petrocola to back up her gold medal at the velodrome with the silver. What do you say? This last 24 hours has just been sensational.
So if we just take away the cycling medals that we won this morning from yesterday's action, 3 gold, 2 silver, 1 bronze on one day of competition.
Huge.
And we also had the news that the Bells, our favourite sports team in the world, are through to the quarterfinals in the gold ball.
To see the Bells celebrate this as well, they're so joyful. The way they approach their sport, the team, mm-hmm. the movement as a whole, the idea that gold ball is actually on free-to-wear, it's getting mentioned everywhere. I think that's one of the real positive parts of this Paralympic movement. It's about bringing sports that have not been seen before mm-hmm. and getting them into the mainstream. Mm-hmm. And hopefully gold ball doesn't disappear for another 3 years. Hopefully these girls come back home. It's able to be developed a bit more. Mm-hmm. We're able to get more guys who are blind and visually impaired into the sport. Mm-hmm. It's able to be spoken about more at schools.
Yes.
You know, all of those follow-on effects. That's what we're here for.
And one of those other sports that is really coming into people's focus, boccia.
Boccia. Dan Michelle and Spencer Cotty, they both weren't able to get wins yesterday. That's when Spencer is no longer in the individual comp, but he does have teams coming on later in the week. Dan progresses through to the next round despite the loss, so we're still cheering bocce, which is amazing, and it is another one of those sports that is unique to the Paralympic movement. So we are sending all the You Little Ripper love to Dan over the next couple of rounds. We want to see him go as far as he possibly can. And shout out also to our good friend Jared Clifford, a bronze medal in the T13 1500 metres. The man is a legend.
He is an absolute freak on the track, isn't he? He's so good.
He leaves everything that is him on that track to seek that medal. It's, you know, I can't say enough positive stuff about him.
And he's got such a huge schedule. So congrats, Jared. A silver in the 5000 metres. Bronze now in the 1500. We'll wait to see what he can do in the marathon.
Rheed, the legend, Hollywood McCracken.
I think, hands down, one of the best names in world sport, Rheed McCracken. Are you kidding?
It's made to go fast.
Well, it really is.
I think that once Rheed was born, it must have been a really quick labour, and they went, this kid's going to go fast. Let's call him Rheed. I'm assuming this is now his normal name.
Yeah.
The Hollywood McCracken. That's his silver medal last night. I love to see that. Rheed McCracken, silverware extraordinaire. Rheed, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
Mate, you did so well yesterday. I loved the race. How are you reflecting on it now?
Yeah, I'm really happy with it. You know, I think straight afterwards, when I got home, my partner Ashley was like, oh, you looked a bit disappointed. And I was like, no, it was just extremely hot and uncomfortable. So I was really happy with it. And, you know, after reflecting overnight, like, it's a big achievement. And, you know, for myself to be able to, you know, be really consistent in that event. Like, that's my third silver in the 100 at 3 games. So medals are pretty hard to win. So I'll take that any day.
What were the conditions like on track, Rheed?
To put it bluntly, bloody hot. It was, you know, we've raced in a lot of different places before, like Dubai and Doha and all these places. And Rio was really hot in itself as well. But just the humidity it was just unbelievable. Like when I got out, when I was sitting in call room and then got out onto the track and I was looking at all my competitors, that's when I was really nervous. I've never been so nervous for a race before. And I was looking at all my competitors, you know, from Finland and Great Britain, and they're all sitting there fine, not sweating at all. And I'm just, fuck, it's just pouring off me. That made me really nervous. So, you know, but the conditions are the same for everyone, I guess. Just dead still in the stadium and hot.
Why do you think you were so nervous? Was it the distance between the last time you really raced these guys?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I think purely just that, really. The fact that 2019 was the last time that I'd seen these guys, you don't know where the gap is, like if they've made up ground on you or if you've made ground on everyone else. I just had no idea. And a lot of these guys did do some of the Swiss series. So they had raced each other a little bit. And, you know, obviously we were in a really different situation. So I think that's probably why I was so nervous about it, to be honest.
Three straight silvers behind your Tunisian rider and main rival, Katila. What is the relationship like between you two?
There's a mutual respect, for sure, I think, because we've raced each other for so long and we've been back and forth for so long. Like, obviously, he's won most of the majors. Well, actually, he's pretty much all of them except for, I think, maybe one, the 800 metres in Rio. So there's definitely a mutual respect there. But in terms of a relationship, probably not as much, purely on the fact that, I don't know what he's saying.
Yeah, I'm surprised that we can be friends because not many people know what I'm saying either. So
struggled daily. I've got to pick you up on something that you said post-race yesterday. Is this true? Did you call Kurt Fearnley a tight ass?
I did call him a tight ass. And I'll stand by those words. They're as true as anything. I don't know if you've been out for a coffee with him. He'll tell you he's taking you for a coffee, but it'll just be somewhere where he's got a free coffee coming up. So
this is all lies. I will not tolerate it.
An internal review will handle this slander, Rheed.
But, mate, this is a dangerous thing. To heckle a person that actually has, you've got 5 minutes or maybe 10 minutes on this show. I've got the next 20 minutes to give you a spray. So it's a bold move.
It is a bold move, but as I said, I'll stand by it and I'll back it. And I think the Fearnley household will probably back it too.
You know what's funny? I was claiming that I bought this virtual seat for Rheed.
Yes.
That happened last night. And then when he called me a tight ass, I had to admit that, no, I didn't buy the seat. I didn't know it was bought. My wife bought the seat. It was at the request of my seven-year-old, and I was asking them both to justify this huge expense. I'm really interested. You're three silver medals on the trot, the 100. Paris is 3 years away. Can you go quicker?
Yeah, definitely. I think, the times yesterday, they weren't really that quick compared to our, personal bests. So I think, absolutely. I think that's what these years are for, to try and, just build up into the, be as best as you can at the games. And hopefully that's what we'll do. I spoke to our coach, not that you're training anymore, but I spoke to Andrew Dawes yesterday, and I know he's got some plans for things coming up. And hopefully, that's all we can do is just keep trying. And as you said, the next game's only 3 years away. But I don't really want to think about that too much right now because I still have another event here. And also, 3 years is so long. And you're the one who has to deal with my breakdown phone calls when I call you and I stress about the games coming up.
Look, mate, I'll take those calls. As long as you're not asking for a buck, we're good.
You wouldn't get one out of you anyway.
Hey, Rheed, what's it like racing in front of no crowd?
Look, yeah, it was a bit unusual. Like, you can actually, even though they say there's no cheering in there, like the Australian group that's in there just seem to do whatever they want to do and yell as loud as they want. So you can hear those people, which is really good, and the support that you get from them. But it is strange. Like, I think that for us racing at like world championships and that, when there's not really big crowds there, kind of, you get used to it a little bit. But it would have been nice to see. It's really disappointing that, obviously everything's happened and there couldn't be a crowd in there, because I think that, the stadium looks inside. It's just amazing. And I think, they would have had, they would have packed it out each day.
Mate, you've been into Paralympic Games before Tokyo. How do you describe the experience in the village that you're in right now?
It's different. It's really different. But to put everything aside, I think they've done an amazing job. It's a great village, really nice. But I think it's unfortunate with everything that's gone on. It's the mask when it's so hot is what's killing me the most, to be honest. I think the food has been amazing. All the Australian nutritionists and that are just working around the clock. Like, I've never seen so much hard work put in before. It's unbelievable. And I think we need to thank them, a lot, because without them, I think we would have been in a bit of trouble.
Well, you're an absolute legend, Rheed, and this is where the interrogation of you by Kurt and me really amps up a little bit here. We're going to play Fast Five, which is basically quick fire questions at you. Just think of the answers as quickly as you can, but we might interrogate you on each of them.
Fast Five.
What do you wish you had in the village but you can't get?
My family. That's a good answer.
We will judge your answers, okay? We're an independent body here, all right? We won't be swayed, but yes, it was a good answer. Yeah, we're giving you high marks for that. Number two, what's your superstition?
I like to have a shower before I race. Something that people find really weird. They're like, well, you're getting up in the morning, you need to go sweat. I'm like, yeah, but I like to feel fresh, so.
Mate, that's the model coming out on you. You want to be on that start line looking good. Don't lie. What's your all-time favourite Paralympic moment?
My all-time favourite moment was winning a medal and being able to see my family in the stands in London. Was really amazing.
Who's your favourite teammate?
Arsenal present.
Any. And why am I?
I knew you were going to say that. I was waiting for it. favourite teammate? I've got two. My roommate, Sam Mack, Sam McIntosh, and my partner, Ashley McConnell, because if I don't, I'll get in trouble.
You're getting so much trouble.
Sam Mack is in the T52 400 metres. He went ninth, I think, in this meet, and he's got the 100 coming up. Mate, if you weren't a wheelchair racer or a bloody quick sprinter, what event would you be in?
Table tennis.
Really?
Well, that's a tough team to crack into.
Tough team crack in, and I'm not saying that I'd do it. I just think I think it would be fun to do. I like watching it, and Danny kills it, so I feel like... Actually, and Millie,
He smashed me in table tennis. I try hard, but he definitely beats me. And then we have to play a decider, and then a decider, and then a decider, and we just keep stretching it out. So the game's, I guess, to be continued. Hey, congratulations on the silver medal last night, buddy. I thought it was a bloody great race, and it's so good to watch you on that big stage again.
Is it a coffee-worthy race? Will you buy him a coffee?
If I've got a free coffee on my card, yes. I will definitely buy him a free coffee.
There's a free one coming up.
I love that bloke, hey? To see him grow into the man that he is, meeting him when he was 12 years old, just growing up also, like being around my kids as they grew up, seeing how much they love Rheed McCracken, seeing Harry scream at the screen yesterday to cheer on Rheed, I loved it. And I'm so grateful to have him in my life.
Is it weird seeing, you know, his 12-year-old just rise and now he is... on the world stage, 24 years of age, that would probably flip me out, I think.
The thing that spins me, there's the same age difference between me and Rheed as Rheed and my young fella.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, like my relationship with Rheed, having known him for so long, and then he's got the same thing, the same age gap, the same potential relationship, unless I don't think Harry wants to be a wheelchair racer, I don't know whether or not that's going to take place.
Don't tell him. Don't ruin that dream.
I will not break that dream.
Don't you do it.
No chance.
Yeah.
It does spin you out. But seeing how confident as well he's come to tell his story and to leave that team, the Paralympic team, and see Rheed find his voice even more, that's been amazing stuff. But we have a massive day ahead of us, huge. Georgie, who are you looking forward to see?
Well, we thought yesterday was big. And, Kurt, there's only a couple of people that I would probably trust to take over the world. You're in there. I think you could be there. But if you teamed up with the man that I'm most looking forward to seeing in action later on this evening, Dylan Alcott, you would be absolutely unstoppable, I think. Well, he is going to be up in the quad singles semi-finals later tonight. Unfortunately, his doubles partner, Heath Davidson, he lost yesterday, so he bowed out of the singles. They'll be back in action on Wednesday night in the gold medal match in the doubles. But for Dylan, it was interesting for me to see him last night because he cruised through into the semifinals against Brian Barton from the US, 616 Love. He's taking on a different opponent who I don't know too much about, but Dylan, he looked a little bit nervous when he was talking about him. And Niels Virk, and I'm unsure Do you know anything about him?
Well, one of the things that would make you nervous is that he's not a regular on the majors. Mm. So it's the person that you don't know that is always the most terrifying one. The guy that you haven't competed against 1,000 times, the guy that's making huge jumps because they are new on the scene or they're young. So they're very hard to predict.
Yep.
You want to face someone that you've played 1,000 times because you'll have all these different outcomes mapped out, and you know what works, and you know what their strengths are, when you know what their weaknesses are. But Niels, I think, is going to be a really tough competitor. The Netherlands team had already beaten, as in the doubles, they had already beaten Dylan and Heath's major rivals in the US, so they obviously got form, and now we've just got to wait and see. But our love, our support, our cheers, everything is going out to Dylan in the semi-final today.
100%.
But it's a huge day. We're going to have to quickly, we have Madison De Rosario.
She's back gold medalist.
Back on the athletics track. Yep. Already won a gold in the 800 metres. Going into the 1,500 metres final yesterday, it was a nervous wait.
Yeah, okay. So the heat, her heat performance yesterday, she needed to finish in the top three to be an automatic qualification for the final. Yes, then it comes down to time. The second semi-final, the second heat was super fast. So I was sitting on the edge of my seat. I know that you would have been too, because I was like trying to do maths again, not my strong point. And I was like, oh my God, is she through? Has she made it? And she did.
She did. She made it through as last qualifier. Mm. So there were a few little parts of that race that I think caught her by surprise. Madison is usually an athlete that really likes to build up, doesn't want to wait until that final sprint. Mm-hmm. She wants to build that last 500 meters to the point where you're breaking and hurting the competition behind you. I think she left her sprint a little late. She was a bit more comfortable than what she maybe needed to be in a heat, because Tatiana McFadden has a great kick, and she kicked in the last 150 metres, and she actually brought two competitors with her, one in a draft, the other on her shoulder, and both, all three, snuck by Madison in the last 50 metres.
Still so tight, but they did.
Really tight. But that just meant a nervous wait till the next heat went. But it was great to see. I know I shouldn't say it's great to see, but as an Australian fan, it was great to see the competitor fall off the back of the pack. The time started drifting out, and finally my blood pressure, it dropped just a little bit. But she's back on the track tonight in the final. She knows her competition. She will know what she wants to do. And now it's just, having already won a gold medal, now I think everything is cream from here.
I really don't think that your blood pressure will be staying too low, Kurt, because we've got another massive night in the pool. Watch my blood pressure just tick up as well, once again, with Team Dolphins. And then also more huge events coming up in cycling. We've moved to the road at Fuji Speedway. We've already had wonderful results this morning, so I'm excited to see what will come there. It's all happening once again, and thank you again for joining us on You Little Ripper. We bring you all of the news, the wrap-ups, the previews each and every day of the Paralympics, and it means so much of us that you are listening to us and joining us to review everything that we are seeing.
Make sure you get in touch on social media, on Twitter, hashtag You Little Ripper, hashtag YLR. Tell us your You Little Ripper moment.
Please.
Make sure you get in touch and say which moment today you look to the sky and yelled,
and remember to tag as well myself at Georgie_Tunny, the very excitable at Kurt Fearnley too. And we do have Auslan translations available. Transcripts are available too. So make sure you are checking out the YouTube channel. All of those links have been posted beneath the podcast. So make sure you're getting the podcast at the ABC Listen app or wherever you get them. And you can find all that information there. Chat soon.
You Little Ripper!